Amen.
To be able to gather around the throne of our great God and sing His praises forevermore. I don't think I'll ever get tired of that. I could sing and sing and sing. And boy, I know this about preaching, whether you're at home or in a gospel meeting. Good singing can overcome bad preaching. Good preaching cannot make up for bad singing. It doesn't work that way. Good singing can overcome bad preaching. You can still leave from a service saying, "Ah, the singing was great." But the singing bad, even the preaching's good. You probably come home going, "Ah, that was the best service I've been to." I'm thankful we've had some really good singing. God's done a tremendous job in directing us and singing some great songs along the way. Some I haven't heard in a very long time, but what a joy it is. I'm humbled to be here. I'm honored to stand before you. It's always humbling to me to look out into the audience and see fellow preachers out there that I respect and admire greatly and whose shoulders I stand upon. Those who have come before me in many regards have helped to build me to where I am and think that they've had an influence in my life. And a lot of times I look out into a number like this and see fellow preachers who've been at it a lot longer than I have. And I think, man, I need to be sitting down there. You need to be standing up here. And when I was much younger and I look out into an audience of preachers out there, I used to be so nervous because I'm preaching and I'm thinking, boy, they're probably listening to me. And boy, I could do such a better job than he does. But over the course of time, I come to realize that I'm in that transition period myself. I'm starting to become one of the older preachers now. They're your biggest supporters. Always have been, and I appreciate them very much for that. It means a great deal. I've always been on the other end of being the mentee. I've always had an older mentor, but that role is now reversed. I'm now the mentor, and I've got a younger guy working with me who's a tremendously talented young man. And she's on the other foot for once in my life, and that's when I started to realize I'm getting older. I direct your attention to Matthew chapter 5 tonight. Matthew chapter 5. For those of you who were here yesterday, as Todd and I kind of talked about maybe what was needed here at Burleson, he mentioned, you know, everything seems to be trending in a very good direction here. The congregation is at peace. Good things are happening. And he's like, I can't think of anything in particular that we need to address. He said, I'd like you to, you know, encourage us. And I can't think of a better place to go than the Sermon on the Mount. It is both encouraging, but also very challenging. It will encourage you as you study it, but it will also punch you in the mouth. Mm-hmm. It will also get your attention. It will also challenge you. And while I'm so grateful that congregations like this are in a good place, we have to make sure we keep everything moving in that direction. We have to make sure that we don't grow complacent and get comfortable in our faith. Because when we do and we stop challenging ourselves to grow, that's when we die. That's when things start to go the wrong way. And so I think the words of Jesus are very appropriate in the Sermon on the Mount. A very challenging portion of Scripture. Matthew chapter 5, as Jesus gets through the Beatitudes, if I were to pick out a theme for the Sermon on the Mount, I think it would be Matthew 5 and verse 20. When Jesus declares, "Except your righteousness exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, ye shall in no wise enter into the kingdom of heaven." Now, prior to this, the crowd was being drawn in by the words of Jesus. He was directing blessings to the poor, to those who mourn, to those who are hungering and thirsty. That was the common people. They had to think, man, he's talking to us. And he's saying, we're blessed. I want to hear more of this guy. But can you imagine what happened when they hear verse 20 all of a sudden? Oh, Jesus, you're pulling in the crowd. Except your righteousness exceed the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you can't enter into the kingdom of heaven. Wait a minute. Whoa. Scribes and Pharisees, they're like the elite, aren't they? They're the super religious. You know, just look at the borders on their garments. Just look at how well they know the scriptures because they're always talking about them and debating them. And just look how spiritual they are. Man, when they pray, they draw a crowd of people on the street corners. And when they give to the poor, they give so much, there's a procession out there. The trumpet is sounding because they're doing so much good. And you're telling us we have to exceed their righteousness? They're probably thinking we can't even match their righteousness, much less exceed it. But as Jesus lays down this foundational sermon that would serve essentially as the constitution of the kingdom, he's saying to those who would truly listen and apply the word of God as he is instructing us to do, he says, look, if you're willing to submit to the righteousness of God, you've already exceeded their righteousness. You've already surpassed them. For the scribes and Pharisees only submit to self-righteousness. The righteousness of God far exceeds that. Now, as he begins in Matthew chapter 5, shortly after that shocking revelation of exceeding their righteousness, he begins to go into a very common setup. You have heard it said, but I say unto you. And so we find that again in regard to marriage in Matthew chapter 5. We get to verse number 27. And Jesus would say, you have heard that it was said, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you that everyone who looks at a woman with lustful intent has sinned, has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. For it's better that you lose one of your eyes or one of your members than that your whole body be thrown into hell. And if your right hand offends you, cut it off and cast it away from you. Throw it away. For it's better that you lose one of your members than that the whole body be cast into hell. Further, as we continue, he says, it's also said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate, a writing of divorcement. But I say to you that everyone who divorces his wife, except on the grounds of sexual immorality or fornication, makes her commit adultery. And whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Now, Jesus started addressing from the very outset some of the more controversial things of even of his day. Some of the things that were notoriously debated among the schools of the rabbis. Many of these things he begins to point out. Here's what you're hearing about these things. This is what you have heard said all of your life. Now we get to a subject like marriage and divorce, and you have two main camps, along with many other rabbis, Rabbi Hillel, Rabbi Shammai. Now there were two different camps regarding these things, and they were always debating back and forth about the nature of it, what was right, what was wrong. There were other debates that raged on, some of those we touched on yesterday, about who is my neighbor, for instance. You know, love your neighbor as yourself. Okay, let's debate that. Who's my neighbor? And so they debated those things. So as Jesus is bringing out things that people were commonly hearing, now we fast forward to our day and time. Have any of these controversial things really changed? Have they really changed at all? Are we still trying to debate who is our neighbor so I can love that person and hate whoever else? Yeah, we still do that. Are we still struggling and debating about the idea of marriage as God sees it versus how we see it? Still the same. Unless you've been hiding under a rock, you recognize that marriage, at least in our nation, is under attack. It's all kinds of things that have suddenly come about in the last few years that have kind of exploded onto the scene. It was not too many years ago that our own Supreme Court addressed the issue homosexual marriage, and whether that should be constitutionally protected by law. We're now in a day and time where people are trying to redefine what constitutes a man and what constitutes a woman. And you could identify as one or the other, even if you were born this way. I tell you what, I tried to go down and get a loan at the bank, and I tried to identify as wealthy, but they didn't take that. I didn't fly with them. Marriage is being attacked. The home is under attack. But this is nothing Satan's been doing that from the very inception of God's plan for the home. Satan has always been trying to destroy this sacred institution. And here's why. Because as goes the home, so goes the nation. As goes the home, so goes the church. Brethren, you can rest assured if we're having problems in the home, there will be problems in the nation. If we have problems in the home, there will be problems in the church. You want to know why we're facing such a problem in the body of Christ with proper leadership in every congregation? It's because there's an absence of male leadership in so many homes. Because so many homes now lack a father figure who exercises godly authority on his marriage and family. And so they have no role model. They have no one to look up to. And so as these young men grow into older men, they're not prepared to take upon them the responsibility of shepherding the flock. Because they've never seen it lived out before them. They're not seeing it modeled. Now you may be thinking, well, you know, the problems all began when we opened the floodgates regarding the homosexual issue. And now we're dealing with all kinds of things. I knew, and I know I'm sure Todd's talked about this and others, but I knew the minute that our nation addressed this from a constitutional standpoint, that it was going to open Pandora's box. I said, as soon as they come out and say something about this being of a right, then what's going to stop the pedophiles, for instance, from coming along and saying, hey, my attraction to children and sexual intimacy with minors, I can't help it. I was born that way. You know, it's just the way I am. And you're going to have to live with that. Guess what we're hearing now? Guess what we're hearing? As a matter of fact, I think it was about a week ago, I just heard a disturbing report from the United Nations that addressed adults and minors and sexual intimacy. And essentially, the United Nations was coming out in support of it. As though, well, this is just part of who they are. You know, and maybe that age of consent is a lot younger than what we've stated. That's what it was. They said maybe the age of consent is a lot younger than what we've been saying. We may think this is a relatively new phenomenon, that this has just started to develop within the last decade or so, but it goes back much, much further. Our problems in the home and the fact that now we're embracing alternative lifestyles and marriage of two men or two women, or I've even seen a person marrying their pet, you know, and multiple men marrying one woman and vice versa. The reason we're experiencing all of these issues is not that we've just suddenly embraced some alternative lifestyle like homosexuality or transgenderism or anything along those lines. It's because we, even as the people of God, maybe turned a blind eye to God's sacred institution of marriage. And we began to make excuses regarding people who were divorcing and remarrying for whatever reason. And we started to excuse some of that. And I speak in general terms now. I'm not indicting each of you here. I believe you're holding to the truth on these things. But as a general rule, we begin to turn a blind eye to those who were divorcing and remarrying for whatever reason. And we began to turn a blind eye toward people who decided to kick the tires before they get married, live together for a while, you know. We kind of let that go, let it roll. We began to make a mockery of marriage in our own nation long before all these other issues came about. Long before that. Jesus tries to address this and to turn our attention to the truth of God's word. How are we going to handle these situations that now seem to be coming more and more to the fore? What are we going to do about the issue of transgenderism? Look, you might think that you can hide your head in the sand because it will never happen in small town rural Alabama. It's coming.
It's already here.
It's come. You're going to have to address it. If it's not already here, you will have to address it. What are we going to do regarding the marriage of same-sex couples or multiple partners or this or that? How are we going to address these things? Listen, the God that we serve has not changed. I'm the Lord, I change not. The Lord Jesus that we serve, he has not changed. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. The gospel has not changed. It is still the power of God unto salvation, Romans 1 and verse 16. The blood of Jesus has not changed. It is still that which will take our sins away. We're not redeemed with silver and gold from our vain manner of living that we receive by traditions from our fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, the Lamb without blemish, without spot. 1 Peter 1, 18 and 19. Sin has not changed. Sin is the same as it's ever been. These issues that are coming up, they're not new. We've been dealing with those from time immemorial. Sin has not changed. The gospel has not changed. Our mission in this world has not changed. Our mission is still to go out and seek and save those who are lost and to proclaim the gospel message to them. We have got to preach the gospel message. How do we respond to all of these issues? Those who are caught up in transgenderism or homosexuality or marriage, divorce, and remarriage for any reason, or whatever we're talking about, addiction, whatever sin someone is caught up in, we've got to love them anyway. We've got to welcome them in just like we would anybody else. We've got to teach them the gospel just like we would teach anybody else. We've got to give them the same opportunity to obey or deny the gospel message as anyone else. Brethren, we cannot determine for them whether or not they're going to hear the gospel. It is not our right to do so. We can't simply look at somebody and say, because they're caught in this sin, they're not going to listen to the message. You're making the decision for them. That's their decision to make. We keep proclaiming the message. Jesus points us to God's plan for marriage in Matthew chapter 5. I want to look at it from the same way that we looked at the previous messages yesterday. There's a common interpretation that Jesus addresses and a divine intention. And common interpretation of God's will and the divine intention of it do not always see eye to eye. They don't always mesh. And then there's going to be a practical application. How do we put this into practice? That's the way Jesus breaks these down in the latter part of Matthew chapter 5. First of all, what was the common interpretation? Well, in Matthew 5 verse 27, he says, "You have heard it said, you shall not commit adultery." Now, wait a minute. Does God's word not plainly say that? You shall not commit adultery. That's a direct quote, right? And that's one of the Ten Commandments. God's very explicit in that statement. But Jesus says, you have heard it said. Wait, what do you mean? You're just quoting. You ever done that with somebody, by the way? You ever been in a study with someone and you quote a verse and someone says, that's your interpretation? And I'm thinking, I'm not interpreting anything. I'm just quoting it or reading it. I've often wondered if Jesus kind of, in this context, maybe the people were scratching their head going, wait a minute, that's your interpretation. Now, as Jesus spoke these words, what was the common interpretation? Were they just misunderstanding the passage in and of itself? No, the emphasis was on the word commit. The emphasis they were giving is this: as long as you don't commit the overt act, then you're good. You know, you can get as close to that line as you possibly can get, but as long as you don't cross the line of actually committing the action, then you're all right. You haven't given in. You haven't crossed the line. Now, to be fair, this is the extent to which man can judge these things. You know, is someone guilty of committing adultery? Hey, the only way we can judge that is, did they commit the act or not? Right, from the standpoint of man's judgment regarding that, That's all we know. But that's not the divine intention. It's not to simply stop at whether I commit the act or not. It's not as though God said, here's the line that I draw, and you can get as close to that line as you want, as long as you don't go over. You shall not commit adultery. But he points out something else in verse number 30. He says, it's also said, so he's kind of joining these two together. He says, you've also heard that it's been said that you can give a writing of divorcement for any reason. This stems from a gross misunderstanding of Deuteronomy chapter 24, where Moses was instructed by God to write a cause for putting away of a spouse. And Moses wrote that one can be put away for uncleanness. Now, what constitutes uncleanness? Literal uncleanness? They don't bathe often enough? Is it spiritual uncleanness? Is it sexual uncleanness? What is that? Well, guess what? The rabbis like to debate that. And they came up with all kinds of ideas regarding what that uncleanness might constitute. And guess what? Physical uncleanness was one of them. They said, look, if she smells bad, divorce her. If she burns your food, divorce her. If you don't like the way she does this or that, divorce her. Now, some of the more conservative among the rabbis would say, now, wait a minute. No, God didn't intend that we just divorce for any reason. There's got to be other parameters to that. And so the debate rages back and forth. What is it? Can we divorce for any reason? Now, here's the thing. By the time of Jesus, the scribes and Pharisees, for the most part, were only concerned that the proper form was followed. All they were concerned about is, did you do the certificate of divorce the right way? No, did you dot your I's and cross your T's? Did you do the proper paperwork? By the time of Jesus, that was their focus. As long as the certificate of divorcement was properly followed, the channels were properly followed, that's what they were concerned about. Not what might have brought this about, why the need to divorce in the first place. They didn't address that. They were only concerned about following the proper procedure. Jesus said, your ideas about marriage, about committing adultery, and about putting away a spouse, these common interpretations about marriage and God's law to protect marriage have made a mockery of it. Made a mockery of marriage. Marriage became a matter of convenience and not conviction. No way. Marry somebody, and if you don't like it, you can always switch which school the rabbi you follow. You know, he'll tell you what you want to hear. Hey, guess what you can do today? You know, you go to a congregation that maybe preaches the truth about marriage, divorce, and remarriage, and you don't like it, you know what? You can probably go somewhere else, and you'll find somebody who'll tell you what you want to hear.
Right.
You can subscribe to another rabbi, and you'll eventually find the justification you're seeking to do as you would like to do. That happened in the first century. It's happening in the 21st century. If time stands, it'll happen in the 31st century. It'll happen in the 101st if God allows time to stand that long. Man, without submitting to the will of God, the righteousness of God, when man submits to self-righteousness, go back to Matthew 5:20, except your righteousness exceed theirs. If we constantly submit to self-righteousness, we'll find justification to do whatever we want. And we'll feel smug about it. And we'll feel justified and we'll feel smug. But when we're willing to submit to the righteousness of God, that changes everything. And that changes how we treat our marriages. It changes how we look upon God's laws to protect the home. Here was the common interpretation that made a mockery of marriage. But what was the divine intention? Go back to the first context. You have heard that it said you should not commit adultery. But I say unto you, that whoever looks upon a woman with lustful intent or to lust after her has committed adultery already with her in his heart. By the way, when Jesus says, "But I say unto you," he was not delivering new revelation. He was not teaching something new. This was what God had intended from the very beginning when he gave these laws. It sounds new because they've never heard anyone teach it quite like this. But it wasn't really new. This is what God wanted from the very start. He says, "You shall not commit adultery." But Jesus says, "I need to address something here." You see, it's not just about keeping yourself from committing the overt act. How can we possibly prevent ourselves from ever being tempted to commit the overt act? How is it that we keep ourselves from ever getting to that line that we might be in danger of crossing? He says you've got to get to the heart of the matter, and the heart of the matter is the heart. He says the problem is within you. It's not in the overt action. It's not in the outward. It's not in the externals. It's within you. That's where the problem arises. That's the issue we have to address. Brethren, I'll say this again about the Sermon on the Mount. I have heard too many people go to places in the Sermon on the Mount and find justification to do something to someone else. I've actually heard people say, "You have a right to divorce your husband because he's been guilty of looking at pornography and he's committed adultery already in his heart, so he's guilty of adultery even." That is not what Jesus intended in this teaching. Jesus never, I'm going to underline this 1,000 times over, he never, ever intended this as your get-out-of-jail-free card. He never intended for the other person to grab hold of this and say, "Aha, I've got you." He always intended this for it to hit you and hit me, not my spouse. It's not so I have an out with my spouse, it's for me. If I want to protect my marriage, I better protect my heart. I better make sure I'm doing what's right. I need to guard my heart. That was the divine intention. It was never intended as God giving somebody an out for divorce. That's not what Jesus was getting at. Listen, the older I get, the more I study from Scripture, the more I see so often that Scripture is really saying, stop worrying about the other guy. Stop so much worrying about the other guy. You make sure you're doing what's right. Jesus wants us to understand, here's the heart of the issue. Here's what leads to the committing of adultery, is our heart. Now, here's why we cannot simply use this as an out, if you will. What if a husband and wife are sitting around and, you know, a woman walks by and the husband, you know, looks at that woman as she passes by? And the wife says, "Aha, I've got you. You were lusting after that woman. I'm putting you away." We can't judge the matter that way. Well, we can't do that. But the man can judge whether or not he was lusting after that woman. He can know in his heart what he was intending in that look. I'll never forget Brody Plyler. Many of you may have known Brother Brody Plyler. He was a great man in and around Jasper. He was a fixture when I was growing up. I thought the world of Brody Plyler. He was a great man. Somebody once asked him, you know, how can we define, or how can we know when we're lusting after someone? And he thought for a minute and he said, okay, it's kind of like this. Let's say you're driving down the road in downtown Jasper, and you see a beautiful woman walking down the street. Anything wrong with you looking over and noticing that that's a beautiful woman? No, not really. But he said, if you circle the block and come back, you've got a problem. You've got an issue. Now, that's when you're lusting after someone that doesn't belong to you. And I always thought that is a great, just a common man's definition of that. I've never forgotten that. I remember hearing that when I was young, and it stuck with me. wife right in the divorce movement, you know, could put her away. But I say to you that everyone who divorces his wife except on the grounds of fornication or sexual immorality makes her commit adultery. Whoever marries a woman who has been put away commits adultery. Jesus gets to the divine intention. God never intended for the marriage relationship to be broken apart. As a matter of fact, God said, I'm going to glue this together with divine glue. For this cause shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave, be glued unto his wife, and they too shall be one flesh. And by the way, that idea of a one flesh relationship goes far beyond the sexual union of man and woman. Far beyond that. Can you imagine, think about this, being so joined together with someone else that you're like one flesh. Now let me ask you, if someone were to come up to you and try to saw you in half, how would you like that? You're thinking, wait a minute, that's crazy. That's crazy. First of all, for a moment at least, it's going to be painful until they get to a point they saw me enough or quit feeling the pain, right? That's going to hurt. That's exactly the point. Trying to divide husband and wife ought to hurt. It ought to be painful because God said, I'm putting you together as one. And that's not intended to be taken apart. Just like your body's not intended to be divided in half. They too shall be in one flesh. God never intended for the marriage bond to be broken. As a matter of fact, from the beginning, there was only one thing that would ever sever that bond in God's eyes, and that's death. Romans chapter 7. That is it. That's all God intended. But you might say, wait a minute though. If God didn't intend for the marriage bond to be broken, and if God said man and woman ought to be joined together until death, then why in the world did God allow a radical divorce? Brethren, listen to me. God has always protected the innocent. Always. And even in the marriage relationship, God knew there were going to be those who would be guilty of destroying that marriage because of their sin, because of their unwillingness to submit to the righteousness of God, to follow their own path. And God gave the writing of divorcement simply to protect the innocent, the one who did not want to divorce, the one who did not want to see that marriage come apart, the one who tried with all of his or her heart to maintain that relationship, but it takes two. And God gave that writing of divorcement simply to protect the innocent party. That was the divine intention from the very beginning. Jesus upholds the divine definition and intention of marriage. Listen, you go over into Matthew chapter 19, you'll get into more teaching of Jesus on the subject of marriage, divorce, and remarriage. And as a matter of fact, this was so radically different than anything they had ever really heard, even though it shouldn't have been radically different, because that's the way God intended it from the beginning. Remember when his own disciples heard it, the apostles, when they heard him in Matthew chapter 19, what did they say? Well, I'll tell you what, if it's like that, it's better for us not to marry then, right? It's better for us not to marry. Jesus said something so profound in Matthew chapter 19. I wish the world could read it and understand it. He said, there can be some who are eunuchs from birth. There's some who are eunuchs made so by men. But there's some who are eunuchs for the kingdom of heaven's sake. Jesus said, there are going to be some who are guilty of destroying their marriage. Now, they're guilty of it. But because they so desire to submit themselves to the will of God, they'll remain celibate for the rest of their lives in order to honor God. That's what he meant by that. He said there are some who are going to be willing to do that, even though that's hard. That's not easy. Especially in a world that says you can marry whoever you want to. Don't worry about that. You know, you're divorced. Go ahead and marry somebody. Enough time has passed. Those who want to uphold the divine may actually have to become a unit for the kingdom of heaven's sake. And I tell you, tell you what, there aren't a whole lot of them that choose to do that. There aren't a whole lot of them. Jesus says, if you want the divine in your marriage, you've got to put God in it. What is the practical application? How do we deal with these things? All right, so if he says, you've heard it said, you shall not commit, that's the overt act, and addresses the heart of the matter, what is Jesus getting at? First of all, for those of us who are married, we are blessed to be married. My wife and I are coming up on celebrating 24 years of marriage. I still look at her and go, sucker. Sucker. I got the better end of that bargain by a long shot.
Amen.
And I can say amen because he's in the same boat.
Amen.
Same boat. Yeah, we know. We married up. And then if you'll remember that, you'll be all right. You always think that, you'll be all right. The trouble happens, both husband and wife, when you think you're married down. No joke. When you think you can do better, that's where a lot of problems come from. Put your spouse on the pedestal God intended for them to be. Lift them up. Guard your heart to guard your marriage. Make sure what you're putting in to your heart will be such that will honor God and honor your spouse. God said there's only one thing in his eyes that will break apart a marriage other than death. And if that one exception is on the grounds of sexual immorality, then I better guard my heart so that I don't bring that into my marriage. Not only should I guard my heart, I need to do whatever it takes to honor my marriage. Look at what Jesus says. It's radical, isn't it? He says, if your right eye offends you, what do?
Walk it out.
Tear it out. Throw it away. If your right hand offends you, cut it off and throw it away. Now, whoa, that's pretty radical, isn't it? Yeah, but if you understand what he's saying, he says, look, you do whatever it takes to protect your marriage so that that marriage can help, you can help one another go to heaven. Or you can follow your own will and do marriage your own way and go to hell. When you put it like that, looking at our cutting the hand off doesn't sound so bad, does it? If we truly understood what hell is like, that would be a small price to pay in order to avoid it. That would be a small price to pay in order to save my marriage. If we could simply talk to those who have been down this road and all the heartache and grief and all of the problems that come with it, how many people would choose to walk that road? Whatever it takes to protect your marriage. Men, and by the way, women, we already know that addiction to pornography is one of the fastest growing addictions in our country. And it's always been an issue among men, but from what I understand, the most recent studies, I do believe this is the fastest growing addiction even among women. Even among women. If you are tempted to view pornography, put your computer in a public place. Look at your phone only when other people are around you. Do something to have some accountability where you can't be alone, where you can't do this anonymously and privately. Make sure that you're doing things on the up and up. If you've done something to create distrust from your spouse, then you do everything you can to be transparent and honest. To those who are caught in some sort of indiscretion, give your wife your passcode to your phone. And she hers for you. Or you can look at it whenever you want. If you have nothing to hide, you have nothing to worry about. But maybe that's another level of guarding our marriage and protecting our homes. That God intended. Do everything you can to guard your marriage. Communicate with one another. I've said this to parents about kids. If you don't talk to your kids, I guarantee somebody is. Somebody is. If you don't talk to your spouse, guess what? Somebody is. They're going to find that person who'll show them some attention. Give them some time. You never know where that's going to lead. we've got to uphold God's plan in our marriage. The church, as a whole, as a general rule, we have to do a much better job about upholding the divine in our marriages. We have got to be much more consistent in how we deal with marriage and home than we have done in the past. Listen, I know a lot of people who are clamoring for all of these things, homosexual unions and transgenderism, who point their finger at the church and say, how dare you say that what we're doing is wrong when you're over there marrying and divorcing 4 and 5 times? And I'll tell you what, in that vein, they have a legitimate argument. That is a legitimate argument because we haven't been as consistent as we ought in upholding the divine in our marriages. We've got to do better. God intends that it be one man, one woman, for life. Jesus upheld that here. Now, to this crowd of people listening on this occasion, this sounded like extremely radical new teaching. Wasn't new, it's radical, because it comes from God. It wasn't new, but it sounded new. You know why? Because they hadn't been teaching it. They hadn't been teaching it. And sadly, what God's Word teaches on marriage, divorce, and remarriage today is going to sound so very new to a lot of young people. Because we haven't been teaching it. Haven't taught it enough. Haven't upheld it enough. They need to hear what Jesus has. But we don't have to go very far to find what did God intend for marriage. Matthew 5, Matthew 19 is pretty easy. It's right there. And there's not a whole lot to argue with when we think about the divine. One man, one woman, for life. That's our challenge even today, isn't it? To uphold that in our homes. And now as we think about how do we protect our marriage and how do we make our marriages better? There's always the tendency in studying the Bible about any subject to think about the other person and how well this applies. All right, Todd, he's been there. Ted's been there. Hayden's been there. Lonnie's been there. Those of you who preach any bit have had somebody come out the back and say something along the lines of, I wish so-and-so could have been here to hear that lesson. Maybe. To the extent that what I'm preaching is the truth of God's Word, I wish everybody could hear it because it's God's Word. But sometimes I think that's the way we think about lessons. How well they apply to everybody else. You need to think about how it applies to me. You want to fix your marriage? Don't think about how your spouse needs to fix themselves. You won't fix your marriage, you fix you. The greatest thing you could ever do for your marriage is to make sure you're submitting yourself to the righteousness of God. But my spouse, they're the one that needs the help. You can't control them. The only thing you can do is you submit to the righteousness of God. And you, through the power of the example of Jesus living through you, hopefully can influence them to do what is right. Greatest thing you'll ever do for your marriage, for your home, for your family, for your co-workers, for your neighbors, for your community, for your church family, greatest thing you will ever do is to make sure you're living right. Tonight, are you living right? Are you living the way God intended in your marriage? Are you doing everything you can to protect your marriage? Are you doing everything you can to honor your marriage? Are you doing everything you can to make sure you uphold the divine in your marriage? And that's what we've got to do. And maybe you're here tonight and you're thinking, I'm not doing what I need to do in my marriage. And because of that, marriage and my family, they're suffering because I'm not living as I ought. Maybe you've already experienced the pain of what that's brought into your life. And maybe you've already experienced the pain of a marriage that's been broken apart because of sin. Greatest thing you can do is live according to the will of God. Submit yourself to the righteousness of God. Even if you know the sin of that, even if maybe you failed in your marriage already, there's still hope. God can still use you. God can still forgive you.
greatest thing you could ever do for that future spouse is for you to submit yourself to the righteousness of God now. Do it now. Do it while you have opportunity. Don't wait. Don't think I've got time and I'll do that later on when I get serious about, you know, finding that one that I want to settle down with. Afraid you might not do it, dude. You might be here tonight never having committed your life to being a follower of Jesus. Jesus lays it down in the Sermon on the Mount, what he expects of his followers. And I'm here to tell you right now, Jesus didn't paint a picture that it would be easy. He did not. And if we somehow painted that picture for you, then I apologize. Jesus never said it was going to be easy to follow him. You get over in Matthew 7, and he says it's going to be kind of difficult. Great is the way. Difficult. It's going to be hard. But I guarantee it's going to be worth it. I guarantee you it will bring joy unspeakable to your life. It will give you a hope that you cannot find in this world. It will give you a peace that passes all understanding. Things you cannot find in this world that you can only find in Jesus. Maybe tonight you're ready to commit your way to him. You're ready to embrace him in the full assurance of faith, to repent of your sins, to confess your allegiance to him, and to be united with him in the waters of baptism tonight. We would love to rejoice with you as you are raised up out of that water to walk in newness of life, hand in hand with the Lord as you begin your walk with him. Maybe you're here as a child of God who needs to renew that relationship and be restored to faithful service to him. Maybe tonight you need encouragement and prayers for your marriage, for your home, for your walk with the Lord. Maybe there's something you're struggling with tonight that you're ready to say, I've got to do what I need to do to overcome this. Maybe tonight you need our encouragement and our prayers to help you overcome that. Maybe you need to come forward tonight because you need some accountability. You're crying out saying, I need help, but I need you to help me. That's why we're here. I've known brethren through the years, I'm sure, Todd and Ted and Hayden and Bonnie and others have dealt with this. I've known brethren who so long for some accountability where they could simply call somebody and say, I haven't looked at pornography today, and that's the end of the conversation. They need somebody to check in with, to talk to hold them accountable. Maybe that's where you are tonight. We're here to help you with that. Do whatever it takes to protect your home, guard your marriage. Let's uphold the sanctity of marriage.